must have a sense of humor. And today, particularly, that the scripture happens to fall on Super Bowl Sunday, because it just brings up this wonderful image of all the people showing up at Simon Peter's house for a gathering, and his mother-in-law is sick. And so Jesus goes and heals her, and she gets up and starts serving food, okay? So it's like, we're ready for the game, Jesus, mom's sick, and no one's made any food. What are we gonna do? We're starving here, and we have no beer. Okay, this is kind of the image that comes up. And every time the scripture comes up in the cycle, it does give a little bit of rankle to some of the feminists in us that say Jesus went, healed her of her disease so she could go down to the kitchen and finish the job she should have been doing in the first place. Interestingly enough, this reflection never came from a commentary, nor did it come from a feminist source. This came from a woman in a prayer group in the church I did my ministry internship in. And we were discussing this, and she goes, God, that sounds just like my husband. I went, oh my gosh. How many times have we read the scripture before and nobody's thought, yeah, just like a guy? There you go. But there's an interesting kind of dynamic that's going on here, because we have two different approaches to Jesus. Okay? On the one hand, he comes into the house, and the first thing is, we need to deal with Peter's mother-in-law. He goes upstairs, he heals her of her fever, and what does she do? She serves. She serves. She serves Jesus, she serves his followers. That is what she's about. Later on in the story, we have Jesus doing what he needs to do the work that he does. He goes someplace deserted, empty, away from everybody, because in order to do the work he does, he needs to maintain that connection with God's source, the source of his power, the source of his soul, the source of his message and his call. And that's where he is. I'm going to put another goofy image in your head. It's like he goes into a dressing room with his name on the door, maybe a little star under it, who knows. And he's maybe on his knees on the floor, maybe sitting cross-legged, meditating, who knows. But he's having that time to connect with Source, that time to listen for that still, small voice that guides him. And all of a sudden, there's a bang on the door. Jesus! Jesus! Everyone's waiting! Where are you? Let's get going! Let's get going! What a different response, eh? On the one hand, the woman that he heals turns around and serves him. And the people that are his followers are hunting him down. Because guess what? The people are waiting for you. Let's go. It's time to go do your thing. You know, that healing thing, that casting out demons thing, that preaching thing that you do. Let's get on it. Let's get on it. That's kind of a reflection of Mark's style, too. We talked about that in the past, that Mark's gospel has that sense of urgency about it. Like in the first chapter, there's like, I don't know, 11 or 12 references with the word immediately. Immediately he does this, and immediately he goes there. At once, at once. And that came out in the first verse. When they left the synagogue, as soon as they left the synagogue, he goes to Simon Peter's house and Andrew's house. As soon as. There's a sense of urgency. Stuff to do. Not a lot of time. Let's get to it. Okay? But Jesus has to have that balance between the urgency of his message and the urgency of his ministry and the wealth of time that he has to take to stay connected to God, to keep that connection going, to keep that power flowing. He's not here to do a traveling show. He's here to proclaim, to heal, and to cast out demons. I think we talked a bit about, a few weeks ago, about this aspect of demons and that how a lot of times commentators interpret this as people who may have a psychological affliction, who may have a disease that shows up mysteriously like epilepsy. Oftentimes people who are possessed in the Bible have these, are described as people whose behavior mimics epilepsy. Okay, so some people, commentators suggest that there is some psychic trauma, psychological break, or physical malady that presents itself in such a way as to make the person seem to be possessed by something inside of them that's taken hold of them and throws them on the ground, foams them at the mouth, causes them to burst out with things that make no sense, episodes of violence perhaps. And the way that they are healed is that that is cast out of them, that that is removed, okay? So we have the sense that healing is not just a physical healing, but it can be a mental healing, a psychological healing, and a spiritual healing as well. These are the three cornerstones of Jesus' ministry: healing, preaching, and exorcisms, okay, which is a form of healing. And this is what Jesus carries through this entire Gospel of Mark. And you'll find as we read these scriptures together, he's very much the opposite of John, who loves to wax poetic about the spiritual hope of Christ and the spirit of what he does and the symbology, the very symbolic language that shows up in John. And Mark is very direct and he's very to the point. And I mentioned this before, Mark is oftentimes thought to be one of the first gospels, the first gospel of the synoptics that show up, the four that show up in our canon. And it is thought that perhaps the fact that his gospel is so unornamented and is just really a straight ahead telling of the story is that people who were reading these gospels, were hearing these stories, were living in a time where they had a very immediate expectation of Christ's return. And so for Mark, his job as a storyteller was simply get the facts straight. That's all you need to know. He came to preach, he came to heal, he came to cast out demons. The healing and the casting out of demons are the proof that underlie his preaching. By this, these actions, you know that what I'm saying to you is true. What happens around him in this regard is a bit of a circus, because when you hear stories of people being healed miraculously of various ailments, you're going to show up, especially if you would like to be healed yourself. If you're poor, if you're forgotten, if you're downcast, if you're downtrodden, you're going to go find this message of hope and this messenger. So in many ways, it was like a circus sideshow when Jesus went from town to town. The crowds were always there. They were always at the door. They were always waiting. But the difference in the story that Mark tells is between the people who are managing Jesus and the people who are serving Jesus. And we see this again in the Synoptic Gospels in Matthew and Luke when Jesus goes to the home of Mary and Martha. And again, there's a crowd. There's always a crowd following this man. And Martha is the one who is serving. Not necessarily happy about it, but it's not that she's unhappy about serving. It's that she's unhappy that she's doing all the serving, because Mary is part of the crowd now. But the sense that there are those who manage him, manage his circus, and there are those who serve. Not the sense that they're caught up in what he does, caught up in what he preaches. They are caught up in what he needs. So, we can be proclaimers, and we can be healers. But perhaps what we're called to explore in the scripture is, how are we servants? And how do we serve Christ? It's an interesting thought. Maybe through your prayer life or spiritual life, asking Jesus, what do you need? What do you need me to do for you? How can I heal your wounds? How can I serve your needs? Can anyone pop up a scripture where he might answer? As you have done to the least of these, you have done to me. I shouldn't say I'm sure because I wasn't there, but I'm going to surmise that as the community of Christians grew, and because Simon Peter was a leader, and because we now know where his mother lives, his mother-in-law lives, there were probably many people that came to her home. Maybe looking for Jesus, or maybe just looking for her, because we all know whose mother she is. She was a server. That is what she was born to do in her life, to serve others. And guess what? None of us is any different from that. We were born to be servers. And so, when we ask, how may I serve you? Then Jesus will simply say to us, as you have done to the least of these among you, that's what you have done for me. That is how you serve me. Words of a song, just, they pop into my head. We are the hands and feet of Christ, serving by grace each other's need. We dare to risk and sacrifice with loving word and faithful deed. Our hymn of the day is number 843. Let's stand and sing together.